we thought of organizing it again as looking at the enthusiasm of the participants, because without even without organizing the wrap up also, some of you had sent the presentation. So I thought, why not have a look at that? At least some of us can appreciate each other's presentations. That will be a nice idea to conclude the butterfly course batch or the course for the year. That was my idea. And otherwise also we are doing everything on webinars. So why not do this one also on webinar? That idea struck my mind, and I thought, like, okay, even if there are not many participants, we can do it. But we are here to appreciate the good work being done and by you guys, and that's why let us look at the presentations of some of our participants who has done extremely well during the duration of the course. So let us begin with you, sir. Shirish, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, good morning all. So first I would like to thank BNHS team, Raju sir, Priyanka, Priyadarshini, Sagar, Kiran, everyone, for helping us throughout the course for everything. And so this is what I am going to share. Nothing new what I learned from the original session and during the course. I have just tried to put it. It is simple, plain learning. So this is a common brimstone from which the name butterfly came up, this thing. Here in the Indian Himalayas also we find this. And the Lepidoptera, which is a name which was suggested, are for the insect, which is for the insects which are having scales and wings. So from this onwards, this butterfly started. One of the first requirements of the first assignment was to write on biodiversity and what it includes. So which include the species, types, varieties, which are already occurring, introduced, brought in, or living there, which also are part of living, non-living habitat of around that. So biodiversity covers everything. And the insects are indicator of the environment around us. So butterflies, moth, they are there for several million years around us and evolved. And they are a good barometer of the ecosystem of the society, and as well as the what is the impact environment is having on the local flora and fauna. So both butterflies and moths, which are responsible for pollination, and once they disappear from the ecosystem, our species would also leave from that area. At caterpillar stage, both moths and butterfly feed mainly on those wheat attack, and caterpillars are the major source of food for many birds. So it is always found that bird feeding season coincides with plenty of caterpillar form. Many butterflies lay something like around 500 eggs, which are about 70 to 80-90% hatch, but only 350 reach to pupa stage. Out of that, around 150 to 175 butterflies actually emerge. So if we see, so that means it is less than 1/3 of the population of the eggs which was laid actually reaches to the final adult life cycle of a butterfly. In the last 10-15 years, about 72% of moths and butterfly species have declined. And it must be noted that the butterflies evolved over a period of several thousand years have slowly adapted to the changes happening around them. But the current rate of habitat loss, which is so high that it does not offer any time for butterflies to cope up with the change and survive. See, this is very important. Whatever has been evolved over several thousand years or through multiple generations of butterflies, and suddenly if there is a loss of habitat or some new pesticides or something which gives a danger to their environment, then for butterflies it is difficult to cope up with that change. And only migrant butterflies such as Painted Lady can survive any climate because it has evolved accordingly. There is also government mass plantation schemes, which is something like eucalyptus or something which are neither native nor adaptive. So these exotic trees don't provide any food chain to the butterflies, and their presence in the forest or around cities is ineffective from the butterfly point of view. Impact of fragmented forest and corridors is also one thing which is need to be done. So due to commercial cultivation of sugarcane, teak, rubber, eucalyptus, the local biodiversity has ruined, as these vegetations do not offer any food to the local butterflies and moths. So with this fragmented forest, the butterfly species, they are stuck around that area and they can't travel, migrate to the other areas because they don't have conducive environment or habitat around that. Excess cattle grazing also ruins flora and fauna of the place. So these are some of the areas. Genetically modified food also can be probably consumed by human, but it is not fit for the local species of insects, butterflies and moths. Butterflies in India, in undivided India, there were about 1500 species of butterflies, and now probably we find around 1200 species of butterflies. In the Western Ghats, which is closer to us, around 342 species are found. Common tit was the new species found in Western Ghats recently, which was also found in the North Indian, Northeast states of India. All six families of butterflies are found in India, and the metallics, which is the least presence in the country. Then again, in the course, what I learned about the difference between the moths and butterflies. So about butterflies having club-shaped antennas and moths having their hairy antennas. At caterpillar stage, moths always make cocoons, whereas butterflies never make cocoons. They hang their pupa by a silky string to the twig of a tree or a shrub. Moth caterpillars have a pair of claspers, where butterflies caterpillars don't have any such set of legs, etc. So these are the main differentials. And of course, day flying moths are also there, and night flying butterflies are also there. So there is a crisscross happening within the characteristic of that as well. Lifespan of butterflies is about, eggs are hatched within 4 to 5 days. Caterpillar stage depends upon the species, is of 15 days of duration. Pupation is about again 10 to 15 days of duration. And butterfly adult life varies between 1 to 2 weeks, and maybe for the larger species, 6 to 8 months have been recorded. A butterfly which emerges from pupa is an adult fully grown and ready to mate or reproduce. Butterfly emerge from pupa early in the morning to protect themselves from the predators, and as the sun comes out, they dry their wings and fly in search of food. Characteristics of butterflies: big compound eyes, no ears, have antenna. They don't have mouth and teeth, so they can only have a liquid diet. Some of the butterflies are poisonous, and there are indicators of that. All butterflies have 2 proboscises at birth, and once they emerge from pupa, the proboscises are joined into a single proboscis. Poisonous butterfly move slowly, as they are not afraid of birds catching them, whereas non-poisonous ones move very swiftly to save themselves from the predator. On the underside markings, which are very important, as the butterflies sit with the wings closed, their upper sides are quite different. Distasteful or poisonous butterflies are often mimicked by the non-poisonous butterflies to confuse the predators or bird. Mud puddling among the male, which occurs always near the flowing water and never around the stagnant waters of ponds or lake. Alcaloids, a moth caterpillar has to cut and eat the leaves, then the juice oozes out from those cut leaves, and which is feasted by the tigers or crow and other species of butterflies. Dwarf specimen of some of the butterflies are smaller in size, even maybe than the gram blue butterflies. But then this is mainly due to lack of nourishment, water, and abundance of host plant at the caterpillar stage it faced. So these are the some of the butterfly body parts you can see: compound eyes, palpi, veins, club-shaped antennas, thorax, then the 3 parts of legs, femur, tibia, and trusses. Then there is cilia, which is the lining at the end of the wing. When you are seeing, they have about compound butterflies, compound eyes of the butterflies. They have about 17,000 visual elements worked as a single unit. And each unit receives light from the unique angle and is converted into a separate nerve. And butterfly almost has a 360 vision. They can detect UV spectrum of solar radiation. However, their vision is always blurry and they depend on their antenna for plants and mates. And colors of eyes you can see from all these pictures. They vary from species to species. Antenna, two long straight feelers are provided at the forehead. They are made of several elements and gradually thicken at the end, forming a club shape. Antennae, olfactory organs, and which help in balancing during the flight and perching. They also have secondary function of detecting light, detecting pheromones, scent detection from the flowers, etc. Proboscis, there is a straw-like tube provided for sucking the fluids, which is, could be water and nectar or salts. Proboscis allow butterfly to reach to the nectar deep inside the flowers. At the birth, two proboscis are separate and later they fuse together. When they are not in, they can be rolled into the coil between the palpi, and proboscis has again olfactory sensors which help them in selecting their foods. Palpi is, there are two sets which are on either side of proboscis, and they have three segment organs, have again olfactory sensors used for detection of foods and other scents. Thorax, this is the strongest part of the body, and it is often used by humans to pick the butterflies without damaging the butterfly. And it has a three segment. Parthorax is the four legs arise. Metathorax is for the four wings and middle legs arise. And the mesothorax, where hind wings and the hind set of legs arise. Abdomen, which is the most critical part of a butterfly, which has about 10 segments. And it also contains the digestion tract, respiration system, excretion tract, and reproducing organs. In the butterflies, blood doesn't flow through arteries and veins like we human have and many other species, but it flows freely through the internal organs and supplies nourishment to the entire body. The heart is located at the back, as in tubular in shape, and the oxygen is supplied separately by a network of tubes known as trichae. And these tubes are opened to the outside air through the openings located along the both sides of the abdomen. So this plays a very important part of the functioning and life of a butterfly, obviously. Legs are six legs or three pair of legs, and each divided into five parts. And the size of the legs vary as per the species. And against the trusses, which has the olfactory sensors and taste receptors, which are used for detecting the foods by the butterfly. Wings, each butterfly has two pair of wing, hind wings and fore wings. And each wing consists of two layers of transparent membrane connected by minute fibers and structurally supported by the thickened hollow ribs called as veins. The transparent members are covered with several rows of scales. Each scale consists of flattened plate arising out of single cell. And then which these scales which offer the color to the butterfly. There are scales have permanent pigmentation, which you can see from the plain tiger distinct wings. And there is a scale which change their color as per the incident sun rays and angle, which can be seen from this banded Malabar distinct peacock butterfly. Then when we come to characteristics of butterfly, this picture you can see on the right hand side is the dew intense on the butterfly wings during the night. And as they are cold blooded insects, from raising this body temperature, they need to open their wings and bask in the early mornings. And the dark colors on the upper side of the wings often help them to take the solar intake. And once they generate enough heat within their body, then they start flying in search of food. Feeding of butterflies. This swallowtails have their larger bodies and they hover around the bunch of flowers and suck nectar without sitting or perching on the flowers. which is more energy demanding for them. Skipper try the other source of food than flowers, which is could be cow dung, dead animals, etc. And they take water from the wet rock, from the rock patches, absorb salt and release water. Here, these Malayan butterfly, you can see, it was actually wetting the bird dropping by discharging water from his abdomen. And with that help of wet, this thing, bird dropping, it was sucking the essential nectar. On the right hand side, you can see yellow jezebel again extracting water from during the mud puddling and releasing the water again through abdomen. This is the way different species approach the food plants. The skippers, which are smaller in size, can actually sit or hang themselves around the flower. Tigers, then the painted lady, they can actually sit on the flower. Something like grass daemon, you can see actually entering into wild ginger flowers. And swallowtails like Malabar banded peacock or the southern bird wing, common this thing, blue marmon, and common marmon, they actually perch this thing, attack the flowers and clasp them with their all legs and then starts. Hill topping is another characteristic where male butterflies guard their territory and they sit on a higher elevation watching intruders. Leopard and common imperial are the two examples which I have shown in the photographs. And the emigrants and grassy blue legs on the plants, and they also use this help to nitrogen fixation of soils. Mud puddling for butterflies sucking sweet nectar from flowers is essential, but some species vary content from the overripe fruits as well. However, they all still need the other nutrients such as mineral salts, amino acids for their survival and then passing on the same to their next generation while mating. So one of the most widely followed ways is mud puddling, and to get these essential salts from the flowers and water streams. There is something called gully bottoming, which is opposite of hill topping, where many species of butterflies gathered in sheltered gullies or drying stream beds during the hot summers. And beside mud puddling in those drying hot springs, they also search for mates. Male milkweed butterflies are often seen gully bottoming in hundreds along with other species. Courting and mating. During one of the field visits, it was observed that male species of cabbage white was approaching a female butterfly basking and probably wanted to mate. But the female butterfly responded negatively by raising her abdomen. And this is an indication that female might have already been mated and would be in the process of laying her eggs. And it's a nature's way of not wasting the resources and helping the carrying out journey of life. So it's an indication for male to search for another female butterfly for mating and continue the cycle. So these are some of the images seen of courting and mating. Migration of butterfly, as the butterfly temperature of around 86 degree Fahrenheit for their survival. They are found most in abundance in warm and humid climates of Asia, Africa, and South America. And the many species from cold climates of Europe and North America migrate to warm areas during the winters. And maybe several species later, they return to original habitats in the summer. Migration of the monarch butterflies is well documented. And even within India, many species from eastern coast as the Western Ghats crisscross these sites for their survival during the change of season. Predators. Predators are not enemies of butterflies, actually. In a way, they are part of the ecosystem or the food chain because the predators have butterflies as their food. So in a way, these predators help in controlling butterfly population, which otherwise would be responsible for destroying their own habitat because of the higher numbers. Earlier in the slide, I had mentioned about if a butterfly is laying 500 eggs, only about 125 to 150 reach to the butterfly stage. Can you imagine if all these 500 eggs would have hatched and reached to the caterpillar stage, how much habitat or the food plant they would have required to survive them and to grow. So predators are again part of the nature's food chain. Then there are about 3,500 varieties of species, these things, keepers. And in India, we have about 277 species. They differ from true butterflies as they are more closer to the moths, this thing. Their antennas are not club-shaped, but they are hook-shaped and called apicalises. And like moth, their caterpillars, pupa remain bound inside the roll. So it is probably a transition species between the moths and the... Then the swallowtail family, which is one of the largest families, and in the world, about 573 known species of swallowtails are found. And in India, we have about 101 species. Many of these butterflies are large. So that's why it is probably one of the most seen species throughout the world. They are also found across the country from Himalaya to the tropical forest. And even the butterflies like crimson rose, they migrate to Sri Lanka crossing the sea. They are active butterflies and wander at a very high speed, fluttering even while they are sucking the nectar. And they are known for laying only singular egg at a time. And most of these butterflies of this family are poisonous or not so tasty for their predators. So pretty safe for them to wander freely. Then when it comes to Pieridae or the whites and yellows, there are about 92 species are found in the country. These butterfly bask with their wings in partially open condition or maybe in a closed condition. They love to bask, but in a cloudy climate would always sit below foliage. And all male butterflies found mud puddling in the large numbers. Their pupa is always anchored upside down to a substrate at the tail end, and which is supported by a silky girdle in the middle. And many of these butterflies are migratory in nature. Then the interesting characteristics of blues or Lycaenidae. There are about 5,000 species of blues, and in India we have about 300 species. They are one of the prettiest and smallest butterflies found in this family. And upper side of these butterflies have very attractive shades of the blue or purple. And most of these species have a tail at the bottom of this thing and have a prominent black spots with the orange circle around it, and which actually help them to survive from the predators, as the predators would always see these tails and the black spot as eyes, and they, while sitting also they keep mimicking the antenna and the mouth, so they have a chance to get away from the predators. Nymphalides are brush-footed. This is the largest family with more than 6,000 species, and in India also we have a good number of these butterflies. And there are various variety of species of this family. They come in all sizes, shapes and colors. Underside of the wings are very dull color and upper side are usually very bright. Many of the male species are known for their hilltopping this thing, and they don't allow other butterflies into their territories. Males of some of these species have the hair pencil that are stroked on to their scent pockets here, and these pencils used for pheromones, etc. Then the Riodinide or the metal marks, which are the judies or punches they are called, this thing. So we have about 16 species out of the 1,000 species which are found in worldwide. And these species are actually were earlier subfamily of Lycaenidae, and they also show the similar characteristics. The eggs vary in shape and often appear round and flattened. The caterpillars are usually hairy, plump, and the common over a wintering stage. And the pupa are hairy and attached with the silk to either of the host plant, to the ground or debris or in the leaf litter. So this is what was the learning for me, because as I come from a background where I had formally never studied life sciences, so to learn these basic things also, it was a very wonderful experience for me. And then I had privilege to meet Raju Kasambe sir, Isaac Kimkar sir, Milind Bakre, Hemant Ogle, Sammelan Chetty, these kind of people, where they helped with a lot of queries, and referring to their books was also a wonderful listing. So Isaac Kimkar sir's Butterflies of India, then Raju sir's Maharashtratil Fulpakhare, and Milind Bakre and Hemant Ogle is a guide to the Butterflies of Western Ghat, which are very useful books which I found to this. Then also during the course, I had opportunity to mingle with all these well-informed butterfly-loving friends from all over the country who have helped me with the enriched experience. So what I want more now, BNHS has showed me the way, and very little I have been able to absorb, which I have tried to convey here. From this point onwards, I need continuous from the BNHS, which will help me to learn more about these beautiful insects. I urge BNHS to create a support system for students like us to keep their interest intact and help in gaining more insight into this Lepidoptera iota. This is last slide.
The session will end here. We'll log in with the same link afterwards once the session gets ends. Okay. You can continue, but I'm just telling the session will end here. We can log in again.
Okay.
Same link.
Yeah, same
link. Yeah, so what I learned is nature is amazing. And for the beautiful and tiny creatures like butterflies who apparently have no mechanism. Can you hear my voice, sir?
Yes.
So in a nutshell, nature is amazing. And for butterflies, which always seen as there are no mechanisms for like biting or stinging available to the other insects, they have amazing ways of protecting themselves from laying eggs on poisonous plants or on the tip of the leaf itself or within the leaf, like red tiro does. Pupa showing signs of aggression, having toxic colors or mimicking the twigs, etc., be probably easily detected by the predators. Female non-poisonous butterfly mimicking the poisonous male butterflies. She is exposed and then get ample time for laying eggs. Once mated, females female signals other males by raising their abdomen so that the precious which are wasted. These are the amazing ways of nature to help be there as a part of the food chain. And the whole purpose of life of butterfly or for the any other species is to pass on its genes to the next generation, and butterflies probably keep doing in all their stages. And we still have to probably learn. I personally have so many other things to be learned from these soul missing insects. So thank you very much. And over to you.
Shirish, excellent presentation. Excellent. Shirish Shyam Potmi is here. Excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Excellent. Really, really, really excellent presentation. This has like everything about basics of butterflies. Okay, it's a very nice presentation. I'm happy. You can do such a nice presentation.
And all the photos that I think most of all the photos are yours. They are excellent. Just superb photos.
Excellent. Good. I enjoyed all the photos. Okay. Congratulations. This is a very nice presentation. And my request is we should do it in 10 to 15 minutes. Because we series are took almost 40 minutes. So with that speed, we will have to stay back here for the evening.
I'm sorry, sir.
Yes, sir.
Tumcha presentation bandh kara.
Oh.
Abhishek, sir.
Yes, yes. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes. Audible, visible.
Just share my screen.
You have to share.
Shirish sir, there are some messages for you in the comment section. Please check.
Okay.
Yeah.
So shall I start?
You share your screen first.
Yeah, I shared. Is it audible? Is it visible? I mean.
Yes. Yes. Yes, we can see.
I can't see.
Okay. Shirish sir, just stop sharing your screen first. वर ऑप्शन आहे स्टॉप शेअरिंग स्क्रीन
केला होता मी मला वाटतं परत पण काही झाला असेल.
ओके नाव ओके अभिजित सर चलो.
इज इट विजिबल नाउ?
येस येस.
So,
Abhijit, you can go into the slideshow mode.
Yeah, I'm in a slideshow mode right now. So, thank you, Shiriji, and thank you, BNHS team, Raju sir, Priyanka, Sagar, everyone who not only build my foundation towards butterflies, but it is I develop a much interest in these creatures, and I'm sure that this journey is just started and it will continue with your guidance, sir. So I will restrict my presentation on my project work, so whatever I have learned. Okay. And whatever I have studied or observed during this course, that I will share. So my project area is actually GNP National Park, which consists of the Gandhi Tekdi area. I will just go to the it consists of the Gandhi Tekdi area, which is a hill, a small hill inside national park, and it covers covered with thick vegetation. Then coming back to from that Gandhi Tekdi area, it has along the road of Canary Caves, towards Canary Caves, it's a open land with some habitation, human habitation. Then there is a part of Shilonda Trail over here, and after that there is a open patch again, which is restricted area. But during morning walk, I used to encroach in that area. So I know that it's not official, but unofficially, I used to encroach in that area just to see the density of butterflies, and as a part of my morning walk. And there is again in this area there is a thick vegetation or plantation of thick woods. And besides that, there is a the Dhesar River, which is a water body over there. So my project area is covered around 6.5 kilometer of walk. And it has all open areas, decidual forest, thick vegetation, and the plantation as well. So I thought the butterfly density is there. No doubt. So next slide. During 6 months, that is from August to January, I observed around 36 species of butterflies. Mostly of them are nampholites, followed by Pyridae. Then three species of Papilionidae, Lancer, and I am not surprised to see that I could able to spot very less species of Lancer. Hesperiidae, only one species, that is grass stamen, and Rhododendron is, that is palm fly, which is oftenly visible in that area. Now coming back to the observation months. Dandied egg fly, then common egg fly, all pansies except blue pansy and yellow pansies, they are spotted throughout the 6 months, and they are regular visitors in that area. The crows, the striped tigers, plain tiger, blue tiger, etc., are available during August to December, and the spotting was very less after that, after December, I suppose. Baronet and common palm fly were visible only for 2 months. And interesting thing is the next butterfly is Pioneer, which I could spot only for 1 month, or rather first week of August. After that, I could not spot that particular butterfly. other than that, our lanthanide, only gram blue and common perio were visible. Plum Judy, again, it is available during the monsoon season. Gros Demon is also available during the monsoon season. So overall, around 36 species I could identify during these 6 months. Probably my observation time, initially I thought that my observation timing was not correct because I used to enter into the park at 6:30 morning and come out at 7:30. So probably that was a not suitable timing for that butterfly observation. So then I started extending that timing, during, especially in Sundays. That is, I used to wander somewhere around 9:30. And then I could able to spot more butterflies or more species of butterflies once I lingered in the this national park. So observations. Pioneer butterflies were observed in early August, and it was hovering around the baby toady palm trees, which is near the teak plantation inside national park. But suddenly after one week or other first week of August, these were not observed in the same spot or other in the project area which I taken. Blue oak leaf was observed twice during the 6 months. One, I could able to spot him basking, and another time it was tree sap sucking. Grass demons were observed in ample quantity till September. That is starting from during monsoon season especially. August and September, they were in very ample quantities, and especially in the area where there is no human habitation, those butterflies were observed in abundance. Now, mortal immigrant were observed in nectaring on tagar flowers. Interesting fact about yellow orange tip and common gull, these were observed again during the monsoon season, and I could able to spot them in a, hovering around, I don't know its English name, its Marathi name is called as Shankasur. It has some yellow and orange colored flowers, and it's a compound flower, and all those butterflies were hovering or nectaring around that particular tree, and it is there on the Gandhi Tekri top. So after September, there is a drastic decline in the identification or spotting of those particular butterflies. That is my observation, actually. In the open area, especially near Silonda Trail, there is a huge open patch, and it's a grassland basically. And after finishing of the first monsoons, that is in the start of August to maybe December or October, there is a huge quantity of butterflies observed over there, especially the tigers, that is striped tigers, blue tiger, glossy tiger, crows, that is common crow, and brown king crow. These are available in thousands. I mean, those were flying over there. I think it is just because of two species, that is Heliotropium and Agartham, I suppose. That is, I'm not sure about it, but Heliotropium is sure. So along with the grasses, there is ample quantity of these bushes where these butterflies congregate to suck the alkaloids. Unfortunately, every year there is a drive arranged by our forest department and one of the NGO, that is Nanasaheb Dharmadhikari Trust, somewhere in October, wherein hundreds of participants or volunteers come inside the national park under the banner of grassland cleaning, and just cut off all those grasses. And with these grasses, all those heliotropium plants are also cut. So after that drive, there is a drastic decline in the observations or spotting of these butterflies. And they just keep a heap of those grasses lying over there. And I could see the butterflies hovering over that dead plants for some days, and after that all those butterflies were vanished as such. So after December, I could not see these butterflies which I used to see on daily basis and huge quantity. So that's the negative part of our drives, that is in drives taken by NGOs. Lansianides, I could not observe much in this project area. However, there is a block called Nagla block, which is extension of national park and separated by Bhayandar Click. There I could see ample quantity of Lansianides. That is, I could see Forgot-Me-Not, that is Common Cerulean and Angle Parrot. All those butterflies I could see in this Nagla block, as well as there is a in the initial approach of Nagla block, there is a good density of butterflies as well. So probably I could conclude, I'm not sure whether it is a relation or not. Whenever there is a more human habitation, there is a likely chances of there is less chances of Lansianides availability, because in the footfalls, in national park there is a huge footfall of persons. Yeah. Now, interesting thing about the mimicking, that I observed a striped tiger butterfly and common palm fly butterfly. They are trying to courtship. That's a classic example of courtship mimicking. Both species are different, but the tiger butterfly, male butterfly, I could see hovering over the palm fly butterfly. And exactly opposite, I could observe in Nagla block as well. There is a male butterfly was stopping over there, and a striped tiger butterfly was there, and male palm fly was hovering over him. So that could be a false behavior of courtship like that. So by mimicking, the butterfly themselves could get confused. I suppose that is my conclusion. Now these are the basking behaviors of which I observed about the blue oak leaf. This is a full horizontal wing position. Then suddenly they close it and then at some angle position. So I spotted this particular butterfly of around 10 to 15 minutes sitting in a basking position at this national park. Similarly, I observed the mating of brown king crow butterfly in the same area. That was a very beautiful sighting as such. Second thing, again, brown king crow, we could observe the male with brand over here on the upper wing. And there is no cell spot, cell spots on the brown king crow underwings. These are my clicks. Similarly, these are the common wanderer female, which a common wanderer male is commonly observed, but female I could not observe many times. This I captured in the Nagla block. And this is a grass lemon butterfly, which I captured in the national park during September, August to September thing. So these butterflies are available, are rare, but these are available as such. So these are all my clicks during my journey of butterfly loving. Thank you. That will end my presentation. So
thank you. It was very nice and short and crispy. And love your photographs. And the comparison was also very nice. Up to two habitats. It would have been better if you counted the number of butterflies here. Still very nice. Congratulations to you.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Lekin abhi bhi lekin atka pada hai corona ki wajah se.
Well done. We are proud of. Kya hua?
Corona ki wajah se atka pada hai internship.
Hello. Raju sir, can you repeat it? Your voice. Hello, Raju sir.
Okay. Yeah. Let us share your experience.
Hello.
Boliye. You. I can. So, nahi ja paaye na.
Am I audible?
Yes, Rashid, you are.
Can I start?
Yes, please.
So, good morning, everyone.
Okay. Hello? Yes, bolo. Continue.
Good morning, everyone. It is good to be back, even though it's a virtual mode. So I'm in this presentation, I'll be sharing my project work. By the way, awesome work, Shiri sir and Abhijit sir. So my project is divided in two parts. Nehru Zoological Park, which is the Hyderabad Zoo. It is called Hyderabad Zoo. So I did my half of the work, project work there. And the other part was done at my own college, Bhavan Sivekananda College in Secunderabad, Telangana. So let's start with Nehru Zoological Park. So please tell me if you can't hear me or see the slides. So this picture that you see is a pamphlet which was distributed to the public by the zoo staff to educate them and publicize that these butterflies are there in their park. So I use this as my reference for the 6 months. And also, I've gone to the park again in February for regular checking on the number of butterflies that I see. And I've used it as a reference. So if I'm dividing all these butterflies based on family, so there are 5 Papilionidae, 11 Pieridae, 17 Nymphalidae, 1 Lycinidae, and 1 Hesperidae each. So in all, there are 36 butterflies. In my 6 months, I've documented all the Papilionidae, all the Pieridae, all the Nymphalidae, all the Lycinidae and all the Hesperidae, but couldn't find 5 of the Nymphalids, which is the Black Raja, Indian Nawab. These two feed on dead crab juices and rotten fruit juices. So I that's the reason why I didn't find it. Painted Lady, because it's a migratory species, I think I couldn't find it. Blue Pansy and Common Leopard, I was told that they're deep inside the garden. Since I didn't have access to those parts, I couldn't find them. But I found more than half of the butterflies. And also a point to be noted is the butterfly park at Nehru Zoo is a little more than 6 months old now. October 1st week, it got inaugurated. So having this diversity is a very big thing. And the graph is just a pictorial depiction. So this idea struck to me while I was doing my work in the park. So there was all these plants were having a small placards with the name of the plant and the species of butterfly it can harbor. So if you have Bahunia, there are a set of butterflies. So in that way, what I did was every time I went in the first month, I think I wrote all the names in one book of the plant and the butterflies it supported. And what I did was I went home and I used one publication of Dr. Krishname Kunte, which was published in Journal of Threatened Taxa. In that, the specific butterfly species and all its host plants list is there. So I used that to take the plants that I documented in the Nehru Zoo Park, and I saw what butterflies can I have. So I overlapped the number of the species of butterflies I found at the park. So on basis of that, very briefly, including only the common species, which I am sure are found in Hyderabad or Telangana, we can have 50 species in the butterfly park of Nehru Zoological Park. Now we have 36, but we can have at least 50 species. My estimate is more than that, but to be as sure as possible, 50 species can be expected. And I have found two new species, two species not recorded by the zoo staff. So this is a tailless line blue, and this is a common cerulean, the second one. So these two were found at very different places, two opposite sides of the park, but outside the butterfly garden. So what I want to say is, since I do not have much knowledge and practice in plant identification, once I get it, we can do a plant survey of the whole Nehru Zoo, and then we can use this method of using the larval host plant as a reference to see what butterflies we can have. And also another point to be noted is larval host plant or the nectar plant is just one criteria, one necessity of the butterfly. But a butterfly needs many more things like the altitude, the environment temperature, the rains, all those different factors. So we cannot say that just because the lateral host plant is there, we can have the butterfly. No. So that is why this deduction of species, which we cannot find, even though we have the lateral host plant, needs to be made. At the same time, whatever common species we can have, which we can surely have, we can have them on the park. So, but these are not, these are just my views, and I cannot suggest this to the park, Nehru Zoo Park. So next one, these are some of the observations or conclusions which I derived based on my time at Nehru Zoo. The potential of the butterfly species diversity in the park is enormous, obviously, given the new species recorded, which is a tailless line blue and common cerulean. And also we need, and I think the staff should increase their view of butterfly sampling or spotting to the whole park area, because not only is there a more more diverse plant diversity outside the park, but also you can have a larger quantity of butterflies which can be monitored, not for the sake of visitors just to show them, but also as a scientific part of the park, which I hope, which I was told was in progress. And also there are some plant species like Bahunia, example again. It has it is a larval host plant for more than one species, more than two or three species of butterflies. I mean, four Lycaenids, I think, Bahunia supports, apart from some more. Plants like these should be planted, and also plants which are unique, larval host plants which are unique to butterflies, which may not occur without them, should be planted in an area to not only increase the butterfly diversity, but also the green cover, diversity of the green cover, the plant diversity. With this said, work should be done towards identifying them and increasing their population by planting more larval host plants. Also, I am a bit skeptical. I do not know this, but please correct me if I'm wrong. On one single plant, there is a certain capacity of butterflies that it can hold, and there might be some competition between two different species or three different species for resources, maybe. But if that is not the case, then well and good. The park is, in fact, in my time of roaming the park, every time I went three times around the park. So it is also a mini invertebrate reserve due to its large coverage. The park is one of the biggest in India. Water bodies, it has water body, its intense green cover, which is quite diverse, which in turn attracts some lesser invertebrates and some small mammals. So it's like a mini food chain, food web or food chain, you may call it. And therefore, I think it should be improved. So this is the second part where I had the freedom to do what I wanted to do. And I also have some questions coming out. So my campus is located in a company called Defense College. So the money has a fortune. In the party, the actual divided family, there are four different species. We are in the image, in license, no identity. And the peer picture. So this is a pictorial depiction of all the species. After listing the names out, I produce the pictures that have been generously the center and all others. So what the set of the view? So we have KLJ. Common rose, lime swallowtail, common marmon. And these are the difference called. You can see some names here. Common have an asterisk mark, a star mark. That means that these butterflies are found outside the college, in the defense colony, but outside the college. In the college, they're not found till now. So that is kind of a comparative project that I did where I compared the diversity of butterflies with the diversity outside the college. In the college. So in Hesperids, common banded owl, and this paper was not identified by me because I couldn't get the open wing photo. But please do help me if you can with the name. And both the Hesperids are found outside the college park, one small park which is made for a few relax.
The family. एक्चुअली योर वॉइस स्पीकिंग थोड़ा सा माइक एडजस्ट कर लोगे क्या आप
आई डोंट हैव अ माइक मतलब मैं
यार अभी अच्छे से आ रहा है अभी 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 ठीक आ रहा
है ऐसा बोलो
हाँ ऐसा ही बोलो तभी ब्रेक हो रहा था
कहाँ पर कहाँ पर छोटा था
दो दो स्लाइड पीछे दो स्लाइड से स्टार्ट करो
या टू और थ्री स्लाइड्स या
या यस यस नहीं
सो दिस इज द सेकंड पार्ट हाँ
ये स्लाइड से स्टार्ट करो
हेलो
Yes, yes, you can start from this slide.
Okay. So this is the second part of my butterfly project under the BNHS butterfly course. So this was done at my college, Bhavan Vivekananda College, located in Secunderabad, Telangana, India. So they were in different, my college located in different colony. This colony has the following has a very good diversity of butterflies and when I divide them in based on families, we have four butterflies belonging to Malde, three belonging to Malde, 10 belonging to Malde, 10 Glycinidae, 2 belonging to Hesperidae and no Rhyodinidae. So the graph just gives you a pictorial depiction of the data in the table. Kept me energized during the butterfly course, not only during the field camps, but also through WhatsApp messages and all. So thank you to all the photos from their laptops. So in the family Papilionidae, we have at defense colony, we have tail jay, common rose, lime swallowtail and common mormon. Common rose and lime swallowtail have an asterisk mark. That mark means that these butterflies are this butterfly or this particular butterfly is found outside the college campus but within the boundaries of the defense college. So in the college, but since I didn't spot it, I didn't include it like so that's why I separated it. And also I did this because I wanted to have a comparative picture of what of the diversity of butterflies in the college and the diversity of butterflies. And the reasons I'll tell you soon. So in Hesperidae, we have the common banded owl and a skipper, which I couldn't identify. Please help me out if you can later. These two are found in fact in only one park in the whole defense colony. And that park is a very small park actually for people to walk and family Nymphalidae. So there are almost all the common species which you see in you have the common egg fly and common castor. These are very common, but I had some like occasional visitors like striped tiger. Yeah, I found after that I didn't find them at all. This was around striped tiger. I found it in the starting around August ending and September starting. Angled castor only once in September, mid September, and yellow pansy. I found it I think in October. October 17th to be precise. The species are always there in the campus. These are the two great and common row. Please note the asterisk marks. Again, angle caster and the great egg found outside the college. All the other infrared are on the side. Family Papilionidae. Only three members are found in the college. Common immigrant, common grass, and common visibles. The three common Papilionidae. Then we come to Lycinidae, and I'm very proud to say that I could manage to take photos of all these butterflies with my phone camera, which actually took a lot of sweating and a lot of weird looks on people. It was very weird. People say, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm photographing a butterfly. Okay. So in the Lycinidae, please note the asterisk marks again. In the Lycinidae, we have the Indian sunbeam, striped toe. Zebra blue, dark grass blue, common lion blue, Indian plains cupid, forget me not, red perio, common perio, and gram blue. And So this is a diversity in the defense colony. Hello, Priyanka Didi.
Yes, yes, Harshit.
Dusra session?
Will
yes, be. Yes.
Yes, yes.
Harshit, Harshit, go back one slide back.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, the second row, first one is a line blue. Okay, she's not. You said something planescupid.
Planescupid. Yeah. Second wala. Sorry, sir.
Wala first. Or second wala is lime blue. Dry season form. Okay. Put your cursor. Show with your cursor. Yeah, this is lime blue. Okay.
Lime blue. This is
lime blue. Second one. No. This is lime blue. L-I-M-E. Lime. Lime blue, dry season form. Dry season form. Okay. Next is forget me not. This is third.
Red period.
Forget me not.
Forget me not, red period. Lime blue and forget me not and red period. And common period and gram blue. So this is just a comparative. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes. Yes, go ahead.
Okay. So this is the comparison between, like I said, college versus the defense colony, excluding the college, of course. So at defense colony, in the family Papilionidae, four species are there. And at Bhavans, we have two. In the case of Pyridae, family Pyridae, we have all the three species found in defense colony. In Nymphalidae, we have 10 species in the colony and 8 species in Bhavans. But a point to be noted is that the yellow panther that I showed you was not recorded outside the college. Only once it was recorded, that too inside the college. And in case of Lycinidae, we have 10 in the defense colony and I documented 5 in the college. Again, gram blue, which I showed you previously, was recorded only in the college campus. And the Hesperidae, we couldn't find in the college. I've been searching a lot near the bamboos, but we do not have any Hesperids there. So the two I found in the colony was, that's it. So the graph just shows the pictorial representation of the data. So the conclusions and future implications for the butterfly diversity defense colony, and for that matter, even Bhavans, is as follows. With the data collected thus far at the defense colony, it is clear that it has a very high potential for more number of butterfly species. The reason for the present diversity, like I told you, I'm going to tell you now, the reason for the diversity. For the present diversity are the variety of plants that the residents of the colony grow in their homes. Like I've seen some very different plants in the some of the houses. Some very very unique. I've even seen orchids in the colony. I'm like, how are they growing kind of an orchid? I'm like, that's not an orchid. They said some other plant. So there are some very unique species. I couldn't identify the plants. But yeah, there are some very good species of plants. And I think that is the reason why we have this. And some of the butterflies, which I couldn't see in the college. I will be cutting this away for the next 1 year to estimate the potential of the colony and its present state and try to improve it. I have started a plant survey at the Bhavans College. So at Bhavans, we had an event, I think 3 or 4 years back, where all the students and the staff members planted over, I think, 500 plants in the campus. And again, of a very different species. And I think that is the result, or that is the reason for the diversity in the campus. And one point I would like to note a bit out of butterfly is that the college has a very awesome. So there are some areas in the college where you put a whole ball full of moths, different colors of moths. And that, I think, is the reason because of the Harita Haram. So there is a lot of scope in Defense Colony and Bhavans College for increasing the butterfly diversity. And if my hypothesis of the documenting the plants under a general plant survey, and then identifying the larval host plants and the butterflies that they support, and accordingly growing them in different places. Then surely we can increase the biodiversity in the colony and college. Once I achieve this in the college to some extent, of course, with the permission of the college management, maybe we can start an awareness program in the colony, educating the people about the butterflies. And maybe we can say, don't kill those caterpillars. Because I interviewed three families, and they said that they kill the caterpillars every time they see them, irrespective of butterfly or moth. So I said, don't kill them. So maybe an awareness at a higher level can be done. So conservation of butterflies, for that matter, is this topic of, I think, a very big concern today, because I'll be telling now, because we all know butterflies play a very important role in the ecosystem. They're pollinators for many plants and food for a diversity of animals that are in play to other large species. The caterpillars keep the plant populations. The crimson rose caterpillars they destroy the whole plant by themselves, therefore not only keeping their population in check but also the larval host plant. So similarly, caterpillars in the environment, the poor butterfly population, and for that matter I would like to say even invertebrate diversity is at a risk of destruction. Globally, the butterfly species are declining, and for that matter, the habitat destruction and degradation along with climate change. So this has become like a very harmful cocktail of natural disasters, mixed and made by humans. So this has to be stopped. We all know that. We are taking steps, but we need to be more research-driven than just going blind. In the name of clearing the grass, you just cut down all the plants which are necessary for those other butterflies which use them. When we say we are losing, also this is a very important point, when we say we are losing certain number of species every day or every hour, when we say we are losing these many species every day, many of the species that are losing are in fact invertebrates. And the reason I say that is because we do not know what those species are. We didn't even discover them, and we have already lost them. So therefore, there has to be a lot of documentation, and also the data should not only be stored, but also measures should be taken to not only safeguard the larger species, but also these invertebrates, because these are like the at the base of the ecosystem. So they are one of the most important producers, and also offer some environmental services. So we have pioneer. This is going on in India. It has started to be pioneers like Krishnamurti from NCS, who has written the awesome book on moths of India. These studies will help these biogeographic and phylogenetic studies will not only increase the nomenclature and our information about these invertebrates, but also they can help us in planning better conservation strategies, not only with keeping in mind not only the big species or the charismatic, the flagship, the umbrella species, but also these invertebrates which are not that known to the people, but again very important for the environment. It is quite evident with the setting up of many butterfly parks for business and duty purposes across the world and in India. And in India, we are very fortunate to have open butterfly gardens rather than closed ones, because we have that heritage, we have that that environment which the butterflies can utilize without them needing any extra protection from humans. So butterflies in India have been successfully conserved to some extent again by setting up these parks in urban and semi-urban areas. And this idea of semi-urban and urban area conservation was I think introduced to me by Harini Nagendra from Azim Premji University, Bangalore. So she introduced this in SCCS Bangalore. I don't know the year, but she said if we can document this urban biodiversity and conserve it, use this as a as not a limitation to wildlife conservation, but as a resource to, you know, do little conservation that we can in the urban area, that will make all the difference. Because this can be taken forward by the government to plant a diversity of native plants in the urban areas, not only to make the urban areas green, which they do promise, but also to restore and conserve indirectly the butterfly species, or for that matter, even invertebrates in the urban areas itself. So we cannot conserve elephants or leopards or tigers in an urban area outside the cages, but we can conserve these invertebrates just by planting plants, just by giving that open space in the urban areas. This will ensure a small urban ecological ecosystem with various benefits, the climate being one, because when we plant trees and we have a small nice ecosystem in the urban area, we'll not only have a better lifestyle, because when we maintain those, we also enjoy it. Who doesn't like gardening? We all like gardening. So why not have a garden in our urban areas, which attracts butterflies? We don't kill the caterpillars because they eat up the flowers and eat up the leaves and fruits and all that. Let's enjoy. Let's yes, sir.
Yeah, please conclude. Already 30 minutes.
Done, sir. So I think urban ecology is one thing that should be encouraged in India. Thank you. Conserve butterflies, conserve life.
Great. Okay. Great. Very nice presentation. What other participants want to say?
Yes, Harshit, of course, right from the beginning, he has been crazy about this, but his work is equally good.
Yes. So that's he's going to be our hero in future.
Yeah, very systematically done work and a great presentation.
Looks like a research paper.
Yeah.
yes, true. Yeah.
I do better.
Well done.
Can I share my screen, Priyanka?
Yes.
Okay.
Harshit has to stop his screen share.
Yes.
Yeah.
Harshit, you stop your screen sharing.
Harshit, aap paani mein dub gaye ho. Aara jao.
Excellent presentation, Harshit. And especially the conservation part and what you want to do for that going forward is really very good and very good steps which you are wanting to take. We wish you all the best.
Hello everyone. I'm going to be starting my presentation now. I'm Kalpana Jayaraman. I teach in a college at Chennai. And can you see my screen?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, we can.
Yeah.
Okay. We can see.
Yeah. Okay. So, actually, I'm not able to find my video icon. Just a minute, please. Where can I find the video icon? I can't find it.
Video icon means?
Yeah, which means I want to start the video. I want to start my, you know.
So that video has...
You touch the screen once, you can...
Do you have sound in that video or just a... Just to show us.
No, I had enabled. Yeah, I wanted to show you people something.
Is it embedded? That's why. Is it embedded in the PowerPoint presentation? Then it.
No. It was. No, it's not. Okay. Anyway, I'll just begin. Just start, and then maybe I can find where it is. Yeah. So I teach zoology actually in a college at Chennai. So butterfly studies as such is not new to me because I have been doing some surveys on my college campus itself for the last, this was still since 2014. And this is what I wanted to show. I have a small booklet that I and my student wrote on butterflies on campus. We documented some 55 species of butterflies on campus. So I just wanted to show you that small booklet. And yeah, I got it. I got the start video. Yeah, so here it is. I don't know how whether you can see that. So I have a plains cupid there. That's my cover and that's one of my favorite butterflies. So thank you. So the question is why I really wanted to do this course too. The reason, of course, was that, can you hear? Yeah. We have a 19-acre campus, and we have lots of butterflies between June and September. And since I began this course, we added 4 more to the species in the last 6 months. So now, totally, we have 62 species on campus. So ever since I became slightly better at, you know, identifying butterflies and learning about the behavior, we started doing these butterfly walks for students. So this was between usually July, when, you know, after some small rains come, and then you have so many emigrants on, you know, it's crazy. So right from that time, we start what is called as a butterfly week. So we just go around and, you know, show them all the behavior and types of butterflies and stuff like that. We also have competitions. We have photography competition, designing, everything. So all this is just to tell you that I think I'm more into, you know, how I can pass on this interest to the students. And of course, it's also a part of my subject, that is zoology. We also want to make them aware that, you know, even this small campus can have so many of the, and how we can conserve them in our around our homes also, and in the college, etc. I'm also very interested in how butterflies interact with host plants, and also how they interact with other species. So with this course, which is what I was looking for, I feel I have slightly more formal background to my studies. And I also hope to pass on this formal way in which you study butterflies to my students. Now, these were the 3 things we were asked to do during the course. We were supposed to go around a particular area regularly to survey butterflies. And there was a field visit also that we were told to, you know, as part of the course we carried out. And of course, a field camp. Unfortunately, because of some health issues I had, I was not able to make it to Sammelan Shetty's Butterfly Park. I really missed that, I feel. The field surveys, of course, were on campus. And this is the survey area on campus. Please do not be fooled by all the green things that you see in the photographs below, because these are just one-off places which are green. And this is where I usually look for butterflies. I know exactly where they come. So here on this this thing here that you see, my arrow mark here, this is, they have, my college is a Christian college, you know, Roman Catholics run it. So they have this garden here dedicated to their patron saint, Saint Francis of Assisi. That's a beautiful garden. And one of the things they asked us for as a zoology department, can you please tell us which host plant for which butterfly? So that was easy to tell them. But funnily enough, not many butterflies come there as they do on this Divi Divi tree we have here, and also this Prinna latifolia tree. They are a hot spot for butterflies usually. And here this is the basketball court, and all the edges usually, there is a bed of Tridax, which attracts so many butterflies. In fact, in another group I belong to, they have recorded nearly 92 species on Tridax. So it's a very good thing to have if you want a butterfly garden. Don't stay away from non-native plants is the message that I'm taking here. So we unfortunately, as I think Harshit, someone else also said, we also have a college maintenance crew that keeps coming and removing the Tridax. So we get very disappointed when that happens. But some things I think management will not understand. So anyway, so this is the place where I did my monthly surveys. And I have just put together some of the host and the nectaring plants we have on campus. I'm still not very good at, you know, identifying plants. So whatever I can, I have written here. And of course, Tridax being the favorite nectaring plant I see. And now here is a very general, you know, a line graph that I'm showing you, that shows the number of species observed on selected days between August and January. So this shows you that somewhere in September, I saw the maximum number of species, and then it petered down by January. Okay, the next one is a pie chart, and this gives you the relative abundance of the different families on campus. And as always, it's the nymphalids which are maximum. And then you can see that the pierids are next in percentage, and then come the papilionids, and then the hesperids and lycaenids. But although this is what my observations have shown, this has, I feel, it's not very scientific. So please have a look at both these things with a big pinch of salt. The reason being that, I have just gone around on one day in a month, and that too for a particular amount, couple of hours, maybe 1 hour, 2 hours. And at that time, what I saw, I have noted down. So this is really not very scientific, because I don't think this gives us the correct picture. So anyway, so this one is correct in the sense that we do have nymphalids maximum and pierids next in percentage, but then lycaenids are many, many more in number on campus. For some reason, when I went around, I have not been able to can someone mute their audio, please? Thank you so much. Okay, so that was about the campus. The field visit that we went, you can see that these are the four of us from Chennai. We have a group named Chennai Butterflies, that's what we call ourselves, and this was the sole field visit we made to a eco-restored spot in Chennai, which is very famous. It's called the Tolkapir Punga or the Adyar Punga. And one of the very good things about this eco-restored spot is that everything is eco-friendly, right from the plants that are there and the buildings that are there. Everything is, to do with friendliness to the environment. So this was a very good trip we had, but for me personally, as far as butterflies was concerned, it was not very satisfying, because I didn't know the plants. I didn't know so many plants. There was this lady who was there, one Dr. Gomati, who was the education officer and interpretation executive. She told us quite a few things. So now I know a few things, like I know that the Indian tulip attracts common Jezebel and the Indian sunbeam. And also when we were there, we saw that the flame of forest was attracting so many pierids. And for the first time, I saw the semi-flamma this picture here, this is the first time I saw the common albatross, the semi-flava form. So few good stuff, and a bit of a disappointment also, because we wanted to see much more. We just went there for those few hours, couple of hours, where we were allowed to go into the park, and we observed around 21 species. Another very, but one thing about this field visit was I got to meet all these others. They are wonderful people, and all of us were very excited to be together. That was a very, very a delightful experience as far as interaction with some of you was concerned. And the final, of course, I could not make it to Belwai, but here Amboli, this was on my wish list for quite some time. And when you said there's a field camp at Amboli, I just prayed and prayed that yes, somehow I should make it. And I finally did. And I'm very happy to have met Raju sir and Hemant sir, and some of you who I've been looking at your WhatsApp email, photographs that you shared and so on. It was wonderful to meet some of you. And I had about 30 lifers among butterflies in that visit. So that was a very big thing for me. And I thank BNHS and this course for me having made it possible. So one of the things is that I'm equally crazy about birds. So this often happens when I go for bird walks, I'm looking out for butterflies. And when I go for butterfly walks, insects. I'm looking out for birds. So it's like you have to go look up or look down, and you can't do both simultaneously. So this is a problem which I hope to address sometime in the future. So what all, for me, the learning has not been just about butterflies. It's always the experience that matters for me. And because I need to share the learning and the experience with others, I very much like sharing, you know, especially with my students. So for me, what is the learning here? And all of you are part of that learning, to be a part of that team, to have people say, hey, come and see this, you know, look at this. And learning that this is rare, this is common, and then looking at all those habitats, that's wonderful. You know, the habitats themselves make everything so delightful. And some of the other things, of course, other fauna, the night walks that we had in Amboli, the, you know, looking at amphibians and reptiles, and the looking at the stars, that was wonderful too. And walking around and being in nature is always something which puts us more, I feel, in touch with our creator. And that feeling also was there all the time, that this is something which is very different and maybe once in a lifetime opportunity for me. So that way it was a wonderful learning experience. And through this course, what is it that I've learned? Of course, the course material was there and I thought it was pretty complete. But these things to do, the monthly survey, this is a wonderful thing which I hope to continue, because it helps us to get more organized in our observations. And small things that I also learned about was about the fruit bait. And also Raju sir, he told us how if you want to actually study a butterfly, and if you see a dead one, you just pick it up and have a look at it properly. That's the only time when we can actually see it. And I will always remember the moth that he showed us with a long proboscis, and how long it was, in all those things I remember. Excuse me. So the course has motivated me to try and identify more plants, but still I'm weak at this. And the assignments that you, the course made me research, were also very, I felt very complete. They're looking at so many aspects of the subject. And I have been, I have saved up quite a lot of publications and research articles that I came across, and I need to look at that, you know. And this, because I went around for the surveys, I saw these two new things on campus, Indian sunbeam and crimson tip, which I probably would not have seen if I had not gone out at that, you know, on that particular day. Another very interesting experience was sometime in September, there was an emigrant migration. So it was mainly, you know, the immigrants and perhaps some albatrosses and some other few periods. The migration was happening throughout Chennai, but it also happened through our campus. So that was really very exciting. We saw these huge swarms of butterflies just moving across campus. And then I was hurriedly, you know, calling up others and saying, why is this happening? What's happening? And then people was, you know, motorists, someone on the road said, you know what? These people are actually staring at butterflies. They're all moving over our heads. So I thought, okay, at least other people are looking at butterflies this way. So this was another very, you know, very interesting experience that happened. I know about migrations. I think this was just a local migration. Usually it happens usually we lose most of our tigers and crows sometime, you know, before, after the monsoons. But then, and then they all come back again during summer. But this was not that kind of migration. This seemed to be some kind of local migration. And we were very excited to be, as a, you know, as a campus, we saw all this happening on campus. We were very excited about it. And what is relating to butterflies and my future plans? Of course, I've been doing this for the last 6 years, and I hope to continue till I retire. So, but I still need with the students, I need to take them to different habitats and make them document butterflies there, and study of host plants is there. Now, we are an autonomous institution, so I hope to introduce into some papers, so which means we may get to make our own syllabus. So maybe in the, you know, the paper on ecology or conservation biology, I'm going to try and push for a small subunit on butterfly conservation. So plus, you know, we can use our own campus for that. And in the campus itself, a lot of, challenges I have faced during this course. That's because right at the place where I used to see a lot of butterflies, now they have started building some small canteen. So there itself, you have a big conservation issue because we have documented so many species. And here you have things which are happening, which you know, that may result in your species number getting reduced. So I have had to face a bit of health issues, as I told you earlier. And our job is, believe me, teacher's job is becoming more and more hectic. And to just get out on that one day of the month itself used to be an uphill task. But still, I think with challenges, we all, the best of our best things come out of the challenges. And somehow we have finished. We finished the assignments, and we already have the certificate. But then, in spite of all this, I'm very happy that you chose to continue with the WhatsApp group. We are still getting all those photos in the WhatsApp group, and I'm really enjoying still being in touch with all of you. So thank you so much for listening to my experience. And I hope that a lot of thank yous are due to a lot of people here. So I'm done here. Sushma ma'am, thank you for your butterfly pick once again, and Harshit, thanks a lot for your student internships information. Thanks to all of you.
Kalpana ma'am.
Yes sir.
Yeah, there is one beautiful photo in your presentation.
Which one?
That photo shows a puffin, and you said albatross. Yes. There is a puffin.
Oh, that's a puffin. Oh no, sir, I didn't know. Because I sent it on the on the Facebook, and they told me it's albatross semi-flavor form.
Okay. Left side, yes.
Yes, I know. We went to the Punga. Yeah. Down.
Yes, here. Down. Yeah, the group of you, ladies.
Yeah.
The left one. Left top.
This one only. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, that's a puffin. Okay.
Right.
Very nice.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So, which means I got one more. Oh, great. Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah.
So, very nice presentation, just like any other teacher.
Okay, sir. Yeah. I think I'm looking at all it from that point of view.
So it will be nice if you continue with butterflies and introduce butterflies to your students. That's the great job I think you will be doing.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Fantastic presentation. Let's move on to the next one.
Yes, Kalpana ma'am, it was very nice presentation. I really liked
Thank you.
Hope to see you soon when you come to Mumbai, come to CEC. I haven't been to CEC, no?
Yes. Yeah, I missed seeing you. I thought you would come for that.
Thank you so much. Yeah, most welcome.
Hemant
sir, are you there?
Yeah, yes.
Yes. So you can start your screen sharing.
I'll share my screen.
We have 5 minutes left for this session. If the session gets end in between, we can log in again with the same link.
Yes, sure. I'll connect again. I will share my screen. Yeah. So everyone able to see? Tenka madam.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, we.
So hi everyone. So in this presentation, I have covered the whatever the basic understanding I had during this course, that is during the 6 months period of time, and I have summarized that entire thing in this small presentation, I would say. So my project area was Sanjay Gandhi National Park in Mumbai. So the base.
Hemant sir.
Hemant, please speak loudly.
Okay. Sorry, my net is a bit down, so there can be some disturbance. Okay. So my project area was about Sanjay Gandhi National Park, which is in Borivali, East Mumbai. Now, these are a few of the photographs which I've taken when I used to go in the morning for morning. And it's spread across 103 square kilometers, which can be accessed from the Borivali side and from the Thane district side. So it's a natural forest, not a man-made forest, I would say. And it is in the center of the city, wherein people can access from the western side and also from the eastern side of the city. Yes. The extended part of this national park is the Nagla block, wherein I visited twice, I would say, during the 6 months period of time. It is a good patch wherein one can walk up to 3 kilometers to and fro. And these are few of the photographs I have clicked in the Nagla block. And this is a list of the butterflies which I recorded during this 6 months period of time. The next one is about why do we need butterflies. A small info about what butterflies is all about. I've kept it very simple. It's already mentioned in a lot of sessions, but I'll not cover too much in detail. Then the basic understanding what this butterfly is all about, what I understood during this 6 months about the head, the proboscis, the antenna, what the functionalities of each of this proboscis antenna is all about. I'll mention those things here. Then the colors of the butterfly. So these are a few photographs, the pattern, the beautiful patterns which we found during this course. And each butterfly has a very beautiful pattern of the on their wings, I would say. How the colors help the butterfly, that is in the way of camouflaging, the falling, the bright colors, the attracting and finding the mates, and soaking heat also. So this was a very interesting thing which I understood during this course. Then the entire life cycle of a butterfly. I had attended few sessions in between. I used to go for the breakfast with butterflies, which sessions which were conducted in Borivali National Park. But I think this course gave a very detailed overview about how this entire life cycle of the butterfly is all about. So and the beautiful photographs which I was able to take during our field visits also. And these are about the butterfly behavior which we studied during our field visits, about the puddling, the petrolling, the courtship behavior, and the basking. So definitely about a good ample amount of good photographs we clicked during this field visits. Even I was not aware what exactly these moths are. This course gave a very nice introduction about the differentiation between the butterflies and the moths. The Atlas moth was one of the moths which I found in the recent during the 6 months period of time, I would say, in Sanjay Gandhi National Park. Sir, just correct me, which I understood was Atlas moth is basically a female, and it's normally after mating the male dies. We can discuss this about once I finish this presentation. So this is a small info which I got about the Atlas moth. So I started about creating this butterfly conservation or say a butterfly garden in my around area. So past approximately 1 year I'm doing this thing. So few plants which I bought from Sanjay Gandhi National Park, Jamaican spike, the curry leaves which I planted over there, panthuti also I planted over there. And luckily I would say last year I found this blue mormon which was present there sitting on the Ratharani plant, the night jasmine I would say. And so no pesticides, anything I'm using there to grow these plants. And let me go to the next slide. So these are the list of the butterflies so far I've found in that patch. So all these butterflies, like I found majority of the times in the month of August till October, I would say. Later on, say from November onwards, the count was very less, I would say. Now currently I can see only the common mormon and the common jezebel in that nature, and the common grass hill. The list of the butterflies which we counted or we noticed in our Belwick camp. So this is a list of the butterflies which I was noting down during our field visits. The other one is all about the Amboli butterfly, the butterfly camp also. Yeah, and I thank the entire BNHS team, Rajesh sir, Priyanka madam, Sagar sir, Samadhan sir, Imant Udli, and all the participants who gave a lot of inputs about the butterflies, their conservation. Yeah, and also the entire participants, I would say. We had a very good knowledge sharing session during our field visits with each and everyone, I would say. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Rajesh.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello, Raju sir.
Hemant sir, very nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Great. Yeah, others want to say anything on this? You can go to the next presentation.
Hemant sir,
you have... Next presentation, Hemant
sir.
Who is that? Sushma
ma'am. Hello.
Ah.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear. My presentation nahi disat hai.
I'll share screen.
Hemant sir, there are some messages for you in chat section.
Oh, okay, I'll check. Yes. Thank you.
Hello,
Sushma ma'am, it's okay, you can just, can you see the, you started.
I am a nature lover. Till now I was seeing things, now I started understanding things and butterflies after doing this course. The most memorable moment was watching common banded devon. This happened in Amboli course. If Raju sir wasn't there, we wouldn't have realized what we are looking at, what a rare thing. The camps at Belwai and another camp at Amboli helped us a lot in knowing butterflies' behavior and many other things. Under expert guidance of Raju sir and Hemant Ogle, we developed an eye to see all life stages of butterflies. Assignment work was real eye-opener. Though it was going through already existing research paper, one should know exactly which paper to choose. We were lucky to have participants of different age groups. Older people of my age are pursuing this as a hobby, but participants like Harshit Mishra is looking forward to study evolution of butterflies as a career option. Even Kalpana Madam, I'm looking as my own hobby, but Kalpana Madam's idea is to spread this idea to so many people, which is a nice thing. My study area is Vetar Tekri, which I am visiting for last 40 years. I was watching butterflies, but now I started understanding the presentation. This is what the study material we were given to, we were poured with study material. These are the assignments. This is butterfly camp, Belvai butterfly camp. What we learned in study material, we could actually see in those field visits, all type of butterflies, their behavior, all stages, we could actually see them in practical. Amboli butterfly camp, it was a real treat, not only because of butterflies. Night trail was the best thing. We saw reptiles, we saw amphibians, we saw many arthropods, and the best part was common banded demon. And then afterwards, the discussion session was the best thing I found it. Ovlekarwadi Park is again a very nice thing. How to spread the awareness of butterflies and the importance of open butterfly garden, which, as Harshit said, it was a very nice experience. My chosen area was Veta Tekdi, which is now it is in between Pune city, surrounded by so many constructions. I like Veta Tekdi so much because there are so many things to do. You can watch live things as well as non-living things like crystals and all that. When monsoon is there, you can have many things to see. When monsoon is not there, there are so many crystals to watch. Trees at Veta Tekdi, my chosen area. But particular interest was there are different slopes of Veta. These are the trees found at MIT slope. And the importance that there are very less exotic varieties of plants in this area. Survey site is Veta Tekdi, different butterflies. These are the butterflies which I found during different seasons. I really wish I could have done a work like Kalpana Madam and Harshit, which I'm lacking. I lack this knowledge, but now I think this, along with those notes, they should provide us how to write the report also. In August, there was a boom of cabbage white butterflies. So many, almost 100 butterflies of 100 cabbage white butterflies were seen. Papilionidae, only lime butterfly was seen. Lysinidae were very less in number. September was grass yellow dominated the Pieridae. Bush brown and tree brown among Nymphalidae were in large number. Number of Lysinidae and Hesperides was less. No Papilionidae was seen during September. October, surprisingly, no Papilionidae was seen in October. Among Pieridae, Pioneer was spotted for the first time. Overall, butterfly activity was less, probably because of rainy season. November saw a boom of Nymphalidae. Many Nymphalidae were spotted in November. December, Pieridae were in large number, followed by Nymphalidae. Only one Lysinidae and no Papilionidae and Hesperidae were seen this month. This is in January. You can see the background. Everything was dry. And there was again boom of Hesperidae. Lysinidae. Threats for the biodiversity of Veta Tekdi, a list is given, cutting of trees, burning, and so many things. Though everything is not negative, there are so many positive things happening by people and by forest department. The assignments we were given, first was to hotspot of butterflies. I had chosen the one paper by Nimbalkar and other person who had listed 64 butterflies from whole area, and he has categorized them in rare and all those things, and he has also provided with the nectaring and flowering plants. Another was pollination study. I had chosen Cinerella nodiflora, and there are couple of butterflies, but surprisingly I found that lemon, pansy and great fly were visiting this plant, but they never those plants very often. There was one more about their migration behavior. Luckily I found this very nice paper which had a comparison of monarch butterfly and painted lady butterfly. What are the positive things and what are the negative things? What are the things expected from civilians? This was again a very nice paper. Butterfly behavior, but this I've read this paper and I found it very interesting. Female butterflies prefer male bearing bright iridescent ornamentation. This was by Daryl Camp. Here they have shown with experiments that how female this is sexually dimorphic butterfly and how female prefer brighter colors, brighter iridescent color, UV iridescent, they like it more. And that's all what I learned from this course. Thank you.
Very nice, Sushma ma'am, short and crispy, very nice presentation and good observations also from you. The monthly diversity and how the butterfly number of butterfly change according to the month. That's also very good observation. You could have added the numbers, that would have been better. Anyway, that's very nice. Yeah, everything is explained with photographs. So very nice documentation by you. I'm sure Vedantikadi must be having 60 to 100 species.
I hope so.
Keep on recording whenever you go there.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Well done, ma'am. Khub chanagla zala. आम्हाला खूप चांगलं वाटतं तुम्ही एवढं सगळं फोटोग्राफ्स काढले, एवढं सुंदर प्रेझेंटेशन तयार केलं.
फोटोग्राफ म्हणजे तुमचं मला आयडेंटिफाय करता येत. आय एम व्हेरी बॅड एट आयडेंटिफाइंग बटरफ्लाईज.
फर्स्ट थिंग इज वी आर लाइक ऑस्ट्रक एट युअर नॉलेज ऑन अदर थिंग्स लाइक द मॉन्युमेंट्स, टेम्पल्स. नाउ वन मोर थिंग यू हॅव, दॅट इज बटरफ्लाईज.
विथ युअर हेल्प.
कंग्रॅच्युलेशन, यू आर ऑलवेज देअर मॅम. ओवर टू प्रियंका.
Yes, yes, Sushma ma'am, very nice. It was you did the monthly surveys and all near that Vital Tikri. And this was our last presentation. And I would like to request some part, if they want to say something, they can unmute themselves and say about their experiences. If they don't want to give presentation, that's fine. But those who want to say something about for other parties or
who
they can.
Hello, this is Nita here. The course was very full. I and Sham both enjoyed attending the course, learning new things about butterflies, doing field visits, and of course the camp at Belwai. And Raju sir and Priyanka were it was very nice. They're really helpful. And also interacting with all the participants was a learning experience, and we treasure the moment we spent with all the participants, especially at the Belwai camp. So thank you, Raju sir, Priyanka, and all the participants as well.
Hello, Raju sir, this is Shailaja here. I had a question for you. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Raju sir, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Yeah, Shailaja here. Yeah, as we all know, some butterflies have dry season form and wet season forms. So, are these butterflies born that way, or do they change the birds do? Do they change their form as per the season?
Hello, Kai, any problem? Just start.
Raju sir, Shailaja ma'am had a question.
Okay.
You can ask again. I guess he was disconnected.
Hello, Raju sir.
Yeah.
As we all know, some butterflies have both dry season form and wet season form.
Yes.
So I wanted to know if they are born that way or they change form as per the season, like the birds do change their plumage.
No. They are born like that. For example, when if you have a butterfly, consider a butterfly which is wet season form. See, it lays eggs. Okay, and then it gets converted to pupa depending on where it lays eggs. Like if around the pupa it has got all the dry leaf litter, even if it is monsoon or summer, it will have dry season form. Okay. So might be the caterpillar understands or the pupa understands whether they are things around are dried already. Okay. And if it is a wet season form, and even in in summer, if there is a patch of greenery and full greenery, and this butterfly comes out in that greenery, that will be wet season form. So even in summer, you don't get 100% dry season form. Okay, you will find some wet season forms, and even in
seen them together in the same place. So.
But especially when the monsoon ends, you can see both together.
Yeah,
wet season as well as dry season form. So depending on where the caterpillar or pupa is there, so it must be deciding on that how to take birth. So that must be a last minute decision taken by the butterfly. Just like poultry, they decide whether to become a male or female, something like that.
Okay. So it's the nature which decides.
Yes.
And one more question. one of the participants during his presentation, he said that he made an observation that the butterfly mimics the butterfly, the original form. It gets confused, it gets confused between the actual species and the mimic. Is it true?
Yeah, they also get confused. Yes, very right.
Okay.